And I got up there, you know, and we had about 50 men there, I guess. And I was like, you know, one thing I learned is the Holy Spirit is not a denomination.
That's right. Yeah.
The Holy Spirit comes where he is welcome.
Yeah. Right.
And where people allow him to do what he does best.
Yeah.
You know, we could have the right doctrine and not have the right heart. In this church, I want to have the right heart and the right doctrine.
Right.
Hallelujah.
I want to know the word. And I want to have the power of the Holy Spirit with me as well.
Amen.
I want to honor the presence of the Holy Spirit. And I want to honor the Word God.
Yeah.
You know, I want to honor the Logos and have the Rhema too.
That's
right.
Come on now. Yeah. I want us to be a good church in a full power. So when people come in here, they can be ministered to. Where families are hurting and their marriage is hurting. Like we ain't been there too, guys. Well, all of us have been through some hurtful times.
Right.
It's just the way it is. They can come in here and get refreshed.
Yeah.
Let this be an abode where the Holy Spirit can move and the people can love on one another.
Amen.
And they can come in here and get refreshed in the name of Jesus. Oh, let it be a refuge, Lord God.
Yes.
Not just a denomination, Lord. Let us be a place, Lord God, where people come and drink, Lord, when they get hurt and thirsty, Father God. Ooh. Come on, people. Can I get an amen?
Yeah.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. I had somebody come up to me Wednesday night, and they said this to me. They said, you know, I'm getting over being religious. I was like, she said, you understand what I'm saying? Yeah. I work on it all the time. And I do.
Come on.
There was an early church father back in, I think it's like 200 years after Christ. And he says, you know, church people in general, you know, they work toward the law. Like sparks go upward from a fire. We just tend to do that. Before God, we just tend to try to keep the rules. We just try to tend to go toward that in our life. The law. No grace, but the law. And it's, some of us are the best at it, too. I mean, we've been at it for a long time. And, you know, and the Lord wants us to get back to that grace in our life. He wants us to get back to that grace. We can take ground whenever we walk with grace. We can move out into ministry whenever we walk by grace.
Yes.
But if we do it on our own merit, a lot of times we don't even get up out of the pew. We don't even start to move out with the Lord at all because we don't feel like we're worthy of it.
Yes.
This ain't right here, you know.
Yes.
We have to allow God to be God.
Yes.
Lord God, by your grace, work inside of me. Help me, Father God, to move out into your Holy Spirit, Lord.
Yes.
Ooh, Jesus. Because I tell you what, when people come in here, guys, and they come to get ministered to, they ain't coming just for a pastor. They're coming for a body of Christ. They're coming for the mamas in this place. They're coming for the fathers in this place. They're coming for the brothers and sisters in this place. They need you. I got a mouth. But they need you. In the name of Jesus, they need you. So be that.
Hallelujah.
Move out in that. Be that. Can I get an
amen?
My heart breaks for them, guys. Because there is a plague upon the land. There's a plague upon the land. And we need to be an answer to that right there.
Yes.
Oh, and in the New Testament, when Jesus walked down the road, when somebody with leprosy came, they said, unclean, unclean. They had to holler it out, unclean, unclean. His, what makes you unclean? The leprosy. The disease that I have has made me unclean. There's not a whole lot I can do about it. Jesus says, you are not unclean. Come here for a minute. Come here for a minute. I want to talk to you. And he was the healer of the leprosy. He was the only one that was healing leprosy. The Spirit of God at that time. And he is going to be the one that sets people free from the addictions of life. See, that's our leprosy now, guys, is that addiction that's going through our land.
Right.
And the people say, unclean. And the Lord says, come here for a moment. Don't be religious with me. Don't tell me where you've been. Come and face me face to face. And I will do a work in your life. I will help you overcome that in the name of Jesus. He's still the healer. He has not changed. He's the same today as he was yesterday.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Because I know. Because once you've been set free, you call him the one that sets people free. If you've ever been healed, you'll say, he'll heal you.
Yes, he will.
You'll see people limping around you, and he'll heal you.
Yes, he will.
He healed me.
Amen.
Set me free.
Thank you.
Gave me a life.
Yes.
And it wasn't a religion. It was a personal relationship with the Holy Spirit in my life. I mean, I sit back on the back row, man, and the Holy Spirit would just get a hold of me. And just, I would be crying and weeping. And I did that for a while. And then all of a sudden, the Lord says, okay, you healed up in the inside a little bit more now. And then he moved me on to another stage. But there for a while, man, I just sat there and soaked it in. I didn't even try to function in the body. I was just soaking it in and getting forgiven and getting my hope back. And the Lord did that for me. Amen. And then I took a step, took another step. Oh, Lord God, I thank you, Lord God, for the next step in our life.
Yeah.
A step of faith, Lord God. A step, Lord God, as we are being led by the Holy Spirit. I tell you what, we need to be led by the Holy Spirit in our life.
Oh, yeah.
We have to be led by the Holy Spirit in our life.
That's
because
right.
if we're not led by the Holy Spirit, guys, it says in the Bible, in Romans 8:14, won't y'all turn there for me? Romans 8:14. I'll give you a minute, and whenever you get there, just let me know. Or you can look up on the screen. It says this in the King James, for as many that are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. I tell you what, that's pretty good right there. And in Amplified, it says, for all who are willing, are allowing themselves to be led by the Spirit of God, are sons of God. Amen. There's a whole lot of people, you know, that are in the church, and they're not allowing God to lead them. They're not allowing God to lead them. So they're stuck in whatever they're stuck in. Whatever it is, guys. And we can make a whole lot. I'll tell you what, it's everything but relationship. Because whenever we are led by the Holy Spirit of God, it's always in the relationship with Him.
Yeah.
Every time we take a step with Him, we have to find out, oh, I've got to have you near to me, Jesus. Because I can't take the step you're asking me to take without your presence in my life.
Yeah.
I've got to have your presence with me, Lord God. Whether I fall or whether I stand, Lord God, I've got to have your presence with me. Because when I take a step, Lord, and I do it in another direction in my life, I surely will fall sometime or another.
Yes.
Amen.
Oh, people don't want to hear that because they want to be sanctified. But I tell you what, if I look at a little baby learning how to walk, and I've never seen one just get up and take off running. They can run up and down the aisles, and I'm like, they got to learn how to do that right there. They got to get up. And all of a sudden, they'll take a step and fall down. Well, come here.
Get back up.
Yeah, I don't know any father says, well, how dare you fall before me? How dare you, I'm a holy, holy father. How dare you fall? No, he says, get up.
Mm-hmm.
Get up. Move on now. Yeah. Learn how to walk. Because before you can run, you got to learn how to walk.
Right.
Don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. Don't be so afraid you never get up. Because if you never get up, you won't learn how to walk.
Right.
If you don't learn how to walk, you'll never know how to run.
That's right.
Ooh, come on, guys. We need to know how to run.
Yeah.
Not only walk, we need to learn how to get up and go on with the Lord. But
yeah.
we grew up in a time, a lot of us did, to where there was a lot of law.
Yeah.
And they said, oh man, if you go out and you do something, you're going to hell.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm like, you know, I've got to learn not to do that right there. And you're telling me I'm not saved whenever I get up and I go out here and I got a good heart and I fall down and I got to get back up and you're saying I'm going to hell? I don't believe so.
Yeah.
I don't believe so. What I believe in my life and what I've been taught is we believe in a progressive sanctification.
Right.
Now, we believe in a sanctification, but we believe in a progressive sanctification where we walk in that as we go.
Yes.
We learn how to let go of things and we grab a hold of the good things of God.
Right.
We ain't all perfect at one time, but we are perfect by His grace and we are by His righteousness.
Yes.
But we got to learn how to walk in all that, guys. We got to learn how to let go of some things.
Right.
Oh, people say, well, I let go of it all one time. I bet you didn't let go of everything on the inside. The Lord says, I look on the inside.
That's right.
He said, I look on the attitudes of the heart. And you're telling me you got everything cleaned up at one time. Let me shake your hand as you walk on that water. Let me shake your hand as you step out on that water sometime. And let me see you walk on that water. Because there's only one that's holy enough that I've seen in my life or ever heard of. That walked on water. And it was Jesus Christ. Why are we throwing stones when somebody falls down? Get up. We need to be a people of getting up.
Yes.
Helping somebody get down the road. Come on, let me help you.
Yeah.
Get up.
Yeah.
Let's move on with Jesus.
Yeah.
Let's move on with Him. Oh man, I tell you what, there's a whole generation that's left the church because they couldn't keep the rules. They couldn't keep the rules. And then when something came into their life, they thought that they had messed up with God. Oh, Lord God, if I'd have kept the rules better, I wouldn't be going through this. Oh, Lord, if I wouldn't be going through this little bit of anxiety in my life, if I'd have kept your law better. You said you're saved by grace.
Amen.
Now, I understand, you know, we can take it too far in our society.
Yes.
You know, some people want to go and they just want to continue to live the old life and not get it right with God.
Amen.
I'm not talking about not getting it right with God. I'm talking about getting it right with God on a daily basis.
Yes. Amen.
And after 30 years of walking with Him, I'm still getting it right with Him.
Yes.
Still asking for forgiveness.
Yes.
Lord, forgive me for losing it right there.
Yes. Yes.
Forgive me for losing my temper right there, Lord.
Amen.
Forgive me, Lord God, for that right there, Father. For that thing in my mind, Lord God, that came through, Lord.
Yes.
It will not find a home. I'm asking for forgiveness.
That's right.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
We need to have hope, guys.
Yes.
Amen.
Oh, yeah, I believe in a holy God.
Yes.
I just believe getting into His presence is a little different than most people. I believe we get into His presence because we are covered by the blood.
Yes.
It isn't because we're so perfect.
That's right.
Thank you, God.
I tell you what, man, some of the most beautiful people I've seen in my life are the ones that have spent a mile with the Lord, spent some time with Him.
Yeah.
And when they spent some time with Him, you can see it upon their face, that beauty of His presence.
Yeah.
And you get near them and you get around them, you'll find a grace about them and a love. Ooh, a love, you know, like a mother or a father that are with a child. Oh, come on, and they'll teach you how to walk. Come on inside of me. Oh, I ain't trying to beat you up. Come on, walk with me for a few minutes. That's the kind of people, because they know how it is to walk with the Lord.
Yes.
They know how it is to walk with the Lord. I tell you what, man, just because we've fallen in our life and we're being led. How many of y'all have been led by the Lord?
Yes. Oh, yeah.
In your life. And how many of you have been in some tight spaces as you're being led of the Lord?
Amen.
I tell you what, man, sometimes we get in some tight spaces as we're being led by the Lord.
Oh, yeah.
We say, Lord, I thought you led me, Lord. I thought you was leading me. And He said, I am leading you. I am leading you. Why am I in this situation I'm in, Lord God? Why am I going through this in my life? Sometimes whenever God leads us, He leads us into places where we have to depend upon Him. Oh, man, there was a guy named Hudson Taylor. He was a founder of China Inland Mission. Now, Hudson Taylor, he was over in China when there wasn't any missions going on. He went over there, and they said he had a plaque up on his wall. And the plaque on his wall was two Hebrew words, Ebenezer and Jehovah Jireh. The first word means, hitherto hath the Lord helped us. And the second means, the Lord will provide. See, we're looking back, and he says, oh, the Lord is Ebenezer. He has helped us to this place in our life. But He's also Jehovah Jireh. He will help us in the future as well.
Yes,
oh, Lord God, we look back, and we see what You have done up to this point, Lord God, that You have covered us with Your grace, Lord. And You have worked with us, Lord, as people, Father. And You have moved upon us, Lord God. But You are Jehovah Jireh. As we step into the future, my God will provide. Our God will provide. Oh, I'm not looking to man. I'm looking to my God. Because He is Jehovah Jireh.
Yes.
The God that provides.
Yes.
Oh, He provided a long time ago as we look back in my life.
Oh, yeah.
Look back on your life and say, did God provide?
Yes.
Oh, He provided then. And I'm looking at the future, and I'm like, hey, I don't know how it's going to work out, but I know that I'm walking with Jehovah Jireh.
Yes.
He's the one that provides with me. And if I slip, He provides grace for that too.
Yes.
And see, God is God, and He is good to us. In John 18, I want y'all to turn to John 18, verse 12. John 18, verse 12. And I want you to put your finger there. Just put your finger there, and we're going to go somewhere else. We're going to go to 1 Corinthians 8. We're going to go to 1 Corinthians 10, 11. He says that these things happened to them, talking about Israel, in the past. Looking in the past. These things happened to them as examples. Were written down in warnings for us. They were there for us to learn how to walk with our God. That's really what it's saying. That God is a holy God, and here's Israel walking with them. And how did He treat them? How did He treat them? He says, why do you, you know, a lot of people throw away the Old Testament. They throw it away, and it's gold. It's gold in the Old Testament for us to learn.
Yes.
We are a New Testament church that studies the Old Testament to know how to walk with our God in the New Testament.
Right.
But we rightly divide the word. We ain't under the law. We're under grace. But we look to see how God treated his people in a covenant relationship. If he treated them in a covenant relationship, we're in a covenant relationship. Now, if he treated them a certain way, I'm expecting that certain way as well. Because he hasn't changed. He's still the same God. He's still the same God. Oh, see, God is good to us, isn't he? Oh, man, I tell you what. Exodus 13. Yep, Exodus 13, 20 through 22. Tell me amen when you get there.
Amen.
I know you're right there because you're looking up on the wall. Everybody say amen. I'm like, I ain't that fast in my Bible. And I've been around for a while. Well, you got it up there, Pastor. What are y'all? Leaving Succoth, they camped at Etham on the edge of the desert. By day, the Lord went out ahead of them in a pillar of cloud to guide them on their way. And by night, a pillar of fire to give them light so that they would not stumble. Neither did the pillar of cloud by day nor the pillar of fire by night left its place in front of the people. Lord God, just bless your word, Father God. Bless your word, Father, as we look at this word today, Father God. Say this with me, guys. He took not away the pillar of cloud by day, nor the pillar of fire by night from before the people. See, the Lord's good. He brought those people by his spirit into the desert. See, he guided them into a hard, dry place. He said, I could have took you up the way, you know, the Philistines, but I was afraid if I took you that way, you'd have went back to Egypt. Because they were fighting people.
Yes, they were.
But I'm going to take you through a dry place. Mm-hmm. And the Lord says that you're going to go through a dry place. And he put them up right up against the ocean. He brought them up right up against the ocean. And they were looking. And here comes Pharaoh's army down behind them. And a pillar of fire came. Yeah. And the pillar of fire got behind them. And he protected them from their enemies. The presence of the Lord, the battle is his. It's not ours, guys. We have to stand in the presence of the Lord. It's him that does that. It is his power that does the fighting for us. But as we go as a people into the desert, how are we going to function? How are we going to go through life? Because sometimes life is like a desert to us. Sometimes we go into places and it gets hard and it gets thirsty. And we're saying, Lord God, I wish I was in another place here. How am I going to do this, Lord? How am I going to function, Lord God? Surely I will mess up, Lord. My attitude will be adjusted here, Father. Oh, a desert place is a dry place. Ooh, before God. And here he is leading us.
Yes.
Man, the Israelites, they stumbled around, man. They were before their God. And they stumbled around. They were stuck on the edge of that sea, and they were looking up at that army saying, oh, we're going to die. Right? As soon as they started going out of sight of Egypt, they say, we're going to die. Our God has left us. And he says, I have not left you. Has the pillar been moved?
Right.
His presence never moved. Yeah. You've doubted me in your life. See, the Israelites started doubting him from the very beginning. And what he said, the pillar will not be moved. Because you have fallen doesn't mean I'm going to remove my presence. Because you are going through the desert. And you're starting to question yourself. You're starting to question my goodness in your life. The pillar will not be moved. All by night it said the fire did not move. Nor did it by day did the pillar of cloud be moved from the presence. It wasn't contingent upon how they acted. That the pillar in the presence of the Lord was with them.
Yes.
See, a lot of us, we think that God's going to take away his presence if we fall in our life. It says the pillar of God stayed there, steady before the people. And it did not move. I tell you what, man, I thank God for that. Because on a day whenever I'm walking good with the Lord, I'm saying, Lord God, I thank you, Lord God, that you never left me nor forsook me. Because if you would have left me for a minute, Lord God, I would not be where I'm at. You had to lead me, Lord. And if I fell down, you got me back up, Father God. And your presence didn't leave. It wasn't contingent upon my behavior, Lord God. I was covered by your blood. I was born again, Lord. And there you were, steadfast with me, Lord God. Teaching me to be holy. Teaching me how to be good, Lord. Because I didn't know, Father God. I didn't know how to do it, Lord. How was I supposed to walk for God? I didn't know. And he says, get up, I'll teach you. I'll take you by your hand and I will help you along. And as I help you along, you will see your enemies scattered. Ooh, you'll see your enemies scattered. See, there is power in the blood. Ooh, there's more power in the blood on heaven's side. Because he looks at us as justified. He looks at us as clean. He looks at us as purified. Because of the blood of Christ. Oh man, sometimes we want to judge people from our stance. We've been in it for 30 years. And we want people to be right there where we're at. Sometimes it takes a minute for people to get a hold of us. Some people don't know about a holy God. So here they were, these Israelites in the presence of the Lord. And as they got in there, you know, they got in there in Exodus 16, 2 and 3. And we'll try to get it up here for you. I'm trying. I don't have my sound guy with me today. It says, in the desert, the whole community grumbled against Moses and Aaron. That would be like the body of Christ, and I'm just using this as an example. Grumbling against me and Pastor Walt here. Now, y'all can grumble against Pastor Walt, but please don't grumble against me.
Come on now.
He's got some thick skin. He's been around for a while. But I'm just saying that's an illustration.
Yeah.
You see how it shifted there, don't you? So they grumbled against Moses and Aaron. The Israelites said to them, if only we had died by the land of the Lord's hand in Egypt, why'd you even start to bring us out here? There we had pots of meat, and we ate food, and all we wanted, but you have brought us out into this desert to starve this entire assembly to death. Here they were walking with God, being led of the Holy Spirit by the presence of the Holy God. Yeah. The fire was with them at night and a pillar of cloud by day. Think about it, guys. The very presence of God was there with them. And they were grumbling because they were going through a hard time. They were hungry. Yeah. They were hungry. And they were in a dry place in life. And here was that pillar. The presence of the Lord was with them. And they sinned before the Lord. They started to grumble before the Lord. But the presence of God did not move.
Yeah.
The power of God did not move from their presence. Yeah. Just because they started to grumble before our God. Oh, in his presence.
Yes.
You know, if it was me, I'd say, I'm taking my presence somewhere else. Y'all don't want me here, I'm going to leave. But that ain't how our God is.
Amen.
He says this, he took neither away the pillar of cloud by day, nor the pillar of fire by night from before the people.
Thank you, Jesus.
Yes. He didn't take it away. Some of you may have said, I'm pretty good. I don't grumble a lot. I don't sin. Well, I'm glad you're like that.
But for me,
and I can talk about my wife and my daughter, teenage daughter. You got to have some grace. You know, sometimes it makes you wink, you know, you just turn your head a little bit. You love them, man. I'm beautiful sometimes, man. I'm like, you're like a rose with a bunch of thorns. Woohoo! Beautiful before the Lord. And then it all comes. I'm like, we got to have some grace here. And if me being an earthly father has grace for my teenage daughter, how much more does our heavenly Father have grace for us?
Yes. Amen.
He said, you're beautiful sometimes, but sometimes you mess up and you leak out that attitude. He said, but my grace will be with you and my presence will not be moved from you.
Right.
Oh, my presence won't be moved from you. It was not moved from the Israelites at that time. The pillar of fire did not leave them just because they grumbled and messed up before God. He was steadfast with them.
Yes.
And here they were. Can you see the presence of the Lord? That fire was up in the sky. And some of them, that you know, they were grumbling and they were complaining. And his presence didn't waver a bit. There it was. It was right there in front of them. Oh, Lord God, let us get our eyes off ourselves, Father.
Amen.
And get it back on you that you are a faithful God. And that you are a God that won't leave us nor forsake us, Lord. Because our battle When we get up to battle the devil and the demons, we got to know that our God is with
us.
Oh, we may have failed, but we got to know that our God is with us. Because if we don't know that, we will cower back and try to find refuge in some other place than in our God. And our God says, my presence has not left you. I have not left you nor forsook you. Stand up in the presence of the Lord and know that you are more than an overcomer. Dust yourself off. Start walking again. Believe God for deliverance in your life. Start looking. Stop looking in other places. Look to me, says the Lord. Look to me, says the Lord. I will give you power. You have not failed me to the point where I have taken my presence from you. My grace is covering you. Get up and start walking again. Get up and start praising again. Get up and start believing God again in your life. He said, he took not away. Say it again. He took not away the pillar of cloud by day or the pillar of fire by night. Come before the people. And he won't do it to me either. Now these people, man, they were not his. And so was I. And so was I.
Amen.
You didn't have to say that. You heard him over there. You heard him, didn't you? That's my assistant pastor. He's like, amen. I was like, I'm not his. He said, yeah, amen. I mean, that's way in the past. Before I knew this guy, and he was over there going, amen, yeah.
Amen.
And there you go. You see, man, they throw stones at me. They're grumbling now in the name of Jesus.
Come on, Pastor.
Get up, walk on.
See, half of you cry, the other half of you laugh.
Praise the Lord.
I can get right with you now. Turn up the speaker. Some of them are going to sleep on me. In Exodus 14 through 20, it says this about the Israelites. This is as they were going out into the desert. Don't forget their situation. They were going out into the desert. They were being led by the presence of God. And they came to a place where they were hungry. And when they got hungry and thirsty, they grumbled against God because they weren't getting their needs met. Their flesh was grumbling. Right. Have you ever been in a place where your flesh says, ain't no way? I ain't doing it, God. I ain't doing it, God. I'm tired of this season I'm in. I'm tired of this, Lord. It is too uncomfortable. And we start to get with God about it. We get real with him. Whew. He says, my presence won't be moved because of that. It wasn't moved for them. Same God, it won't be moved for you either.
Yes.
Now here's the Israelites here now. When the dew was gone, the flakes like frost on the ground appeared on the desert floor. When the Israelites saw it, they said to each other, what is it? For they did not know what it was. Moses said to them, it is the bread the Lord has given to you to eat. This is the Lord's commandment to you. Everyone is together as much as they need. Take an omer, which is about a quart, for each person to have in your tent. The Israelites did as they were told. Some gathered much and some gathered little. And when they measured about an omer, the one that gathered much did not have too much. And the one that gathered a little didn't have too little. Everyone had gathered just about as much as they needed. Then Moses said to them, no one is to take any of it until morning. He's like, don't take it into your tent. You keep the blessing of God in your tent until morning. You see, a lot of us, we want to take the blessing and keep it until morning. And all of a sudden, we done messed up the blessing of God in our life. He brought a blessing to him, and he says, I'm bringing you food. I'm bringing you food. You're being led of the Lord. I'm bringing you companionship. I'm bringing relationship into your life. I'm bringing these things to you, but don't keep it into morning. Don't take it into your tent and do things you ain't supposed to be doing until morning. You've got to do it my way or it won't be a blessing anymore.
Right.
Oh, come on, guys. God wants to bless his people. But a lot of us, we don't want to listen to the rules that go along with the blessing.
Right. Amen.
Oh, man, we want to do with bread what we want to do with the bread. Oh, Lord God, I want to do what I want to do.
Come on.
Mm-hmm. Are you with me now, brother, up here on the screen? Oh, man, I got my man back here now. I ain't got to deal with this. Praise the Lord. I tell you what, whenever I was in Bible college, they said, no PDA. I was like, what is that? PDA. I had to go ask somebody what they mean, because I was a sinner saved by grace. And I was going to this Bible college, and everybody up there was like, pastor's kids, PKs. All of them could sing, and they could do all kinds of things. Beautiful. I was like, what's PDA mean? Public display of affection. You mean I can't even go and hold that girl's hand? No. I was like, I'm leaving. Because there was some fine-looking girls down there. But I tell you what, that was some pastor's kids. He was like, mm-hmm. I was like, I got to get out of here. But I stayed for 4 years. I did. I learned how to walk. I learned how to do what was right before the Lord.
Amen.
But I tell you what, man, you couldn't keep your bread overnight. You had to learn how to do it right before the Lord. It said that they mishandled it. Look, however, in verse 20 right here, some of them paid no attention to Moses. They kept part of it until morning. But it was full of maggots and began to smell. So Moses was angry with them. Because what did they do? He was angry with them because they mishandled the bread from heaven. They mishandled the bread that God gave them from heaven. Things started to stink in their life. Things started to smell up in their house. Because they mishandled the heavenly gift. The gift from the Lord that he gave them, they mishandled it. It tasted like honey whenever they did it right. Yeah. But whenever they did it wrong, it started to have maggots and stink.
Yeah.
How can a blessing turn from a blessing into a curse? Yeah. It happens whenever we mishandle it.
Right.
Oh, man, if we mishandle things before God, things start to, we have repercussions.
Yeah.
We start to have repercussions, and it starts to stink. And the Lord says, I meant that for a blessing for you, but you've mishandled it.
Come on.
But even if you mishandled it, my presence will not be taken away.
Yes.
Even though I have to correct you in this situation, my presence will not be taken away. It was not taken away from the Israelites. It will not be taken away from you either.
Yes.
As I corrected them, I corrected them.
Amen.
But I did not take away my presence from them. As I corrected them, the fire was there by night and the smoke was there by day. It was there by day whether I was correcting them or I wasn't correcting them. If they were doing good, it was there. If they weren't doing good, it was there. My faithfulness is faithful. See, the Lord is much faithful or more faithful than we are. And his presence is there. Now, I guarantee you sometimes they wish it wasn't there. Because they're like, man, the Lord can correct us at a level that nobody else can.
Yeah.
Oh, man, I tell you what, he can correct us and get us corrected. But whenever he corrects us, he gets the right result. Whenever I do it, a lot of times you get anger and all that stuff. I mean, come on. See, the Lord is good. Lord God, even though you're correcting us, some of us here, Lord, you're not taking your presence from us, Father.
Right.
Oh, man, sometimes we've mishandled the bread from heaven, too. Sometimes we've done wrong before the Lord.
Yeah.
And he took not his presence from us. He's faithful like that. He is beautiful like that. How many of you in here need to hear that today? That the Lord says, no, I am with you. As you walk, don't sit there in a ditch before me and hide your treasure up under your where you're hiding. And the Lord says, where's your talent? Well, I hid it, Lord. I was scared that you'd come, Lord God, and ask me about what I've done in my life. And I've hid the things in my life, Lord, because I was scared to walk before you because you're a holy God.
Yeah.
And there's only a few people can be so holy as that, Lord. And the thing of it is we all are not that holy.
That's right.
What, none of us.
That's right.
They can stand at home and they can sit up in their living room and you can be real holy there.
Hello,
shut all the doors and all the blinds. Turn off the TV and everything. You can be real holy there. Get a job.
Amen.
Get out there and rub it with some people.
That's right.
And then all of a sudden you're going to have grace in your life.
Amen.
Start asking God, forgive me, Lord God, for not loving my brother. Because I love myself. I'm just putting us all on the same level, guys. Because there's people that don't want to join the body because they feel like I can't live up to it.
Come on, Pastor.
I can't live up to it. I am not what I used to be. But I am not what I'm going to be either.
Right.
Man, I'm a work in progress.
Amen.
I'm a work in progress.
Amen.
Now, I ain't out there just blatantly sinning, guys. I've been doing this for 30 years, and I have walked away from the Lord at a time in my life. But when I turned to return to Him, He put a ring back on my hand. Ooh, and He put a robe on me. It's a function in the kingdom of God. Get up and start walking again.
Right.
You have power in your life. You have move in your life. You have these things. My presence isn't taken away from you. I would not have come out of what I came out of if the presence of the Lord was not with me. If the presence of the Lord had left me, I would have never found my way back. All the world and all the spirits in the world would have wrapped me up and just took me on. But my God is more faithful than that. My God is faithful. And He says, I will take you back. Turn your heart toward me. And He just pulled me right back. I will leave the 99 and I'll go after the one. It ain't got nothing to do with the one. He loves the one.
Yes, He does.
He loves the one. Oh, the Lord is right here with us, guys. You know, we can say, Lord, I have messed up in my life. I have messed up, Lord. And I don't feel your presence, Father. The Lord says, I am right here. I haven't left you. I am right here with you. Oh, come on, guys. That's good stuff right there. Oh, the Lord is good. Oh, the Lord is good to us. You know, the Lord is good to us. I remember being a pastor. I've seen a lot of little kids come down the aisles, you know, during weddings. And they'd be throwing the little rose petals. You know, the ones in the little white dresses, the little girls, and they'd be holding the little thing. And they just look so beautiful coming down through there. And they'd be throwing their little rose petals here and there. And I'm like, you know, that's precious. And the little boy will come with a little pillow with rings on it. And I'm like, they got to have those rings tied then. Because if it was me, man, I'd have done dropped it. I'd have been talking to somebody over to... So here they come, and they look so beautiful, man. Oh, man, you know, when we're around a wedding, man... You know, we look at them, and the bride comes down, and she's so beautiful, and it looks like such a happy occasion, doesn't it, guys? Oh, man, it's such a happy occasion, you know. Oh, man, there's two people coming to be one, and they get married. And, oh, man, they just look like they're just, it's so beautiful, man. It's nothing could be more beautiful than that. Oh, Lord God, surely they're going to be blessed all their days, and they'll never fight, Lord God. Look at them, and you know that's a farce, guys. You know that's a farce right there, because the people that you love is sometimes the people that you rob. Yeah, you love them, but you rob them as well. Because you're up in the house with them, and you say, I love you, honey. She said, but you rubbed me wrong. Oh, man, I tell you what, I try not to rub my wife wrong, because she can argue longer than I can. I'm like, I'm going to take a nap. Because you don't wore me out. Because I'm about a 10,000 word a day guy. She's about a 50,000 word a day. So whenever you come down, you see all these people. And everybody's nervous at the wedding. And the pastor gets up and says, marriage is a joyous occasion. Yes. Ooh, and it is a joyous occasion. You see, marriage is for the good times. And marriage is also for the rough times.
Right.
And if we're supposed to be faithful before our God in the good times... And in the bad times.
Uh-huh.
How much more will our God be faithful in the good times?
Right.
And also the bad times.
Right.
Ooh, if we're supposed to be that way in our marriage. It says in the Bible that marriage is just a picture of bride, of Christ and His bride.
Yeah.
How much more will He be faithful? Yes. How much more will He be faithful? We've been taught something here in theology that God is a God that will leave us quick if we stumble around and lose our attention. I tell you what, whenever I was a boy, they had to come and get me a bunch of times. Oh, come on, keep your attention over here, son. My daddy had to say, come here. Come here now. What are you doing over there poking at that cow? Come here. I got to have your attention. And we're the same way. We lose our attention sometimes.
Yes.
And we get out there.
Yes.
He said, my presence won't move from you.
That's right.
His presence won't move from you.
Thank you.
There's a few things that really cut us off from God in life, And I'll go over those later on, man. But I'll tell you what, there's a few things in the New Testament that says, you know, that whenever they first came to the disciples and the new church was being birthed, and they said, whoa, man, what can we do? What should we do? He said, don't lay any law on them other than this. Their sacrifice and things strangled and blood. I don't deal with idols. I don't try to have satanic things and tarot cards up in my house. I don't want those things. And I don't think the Lord's going to... It opens the door for the enemy.
Yes, it does.
It does. It opens the door for the enemy when you got that stuff around. When you're dealing with the witchcraft and stuff, you're like, oh, Lord, I love you, but it opened the back door to the devil. Allow him to come up in there. I'll tell you what, no wonder people are having nightmares.
Come on, Pastor.
Because you're opening the door, man. That witchcraft isn't of the Lord.
That's
amen.
Right.
That's right.
And there's another one. Premarital sex.
Come on.
Sex.
That's right.
Sex, man, it says in the Word, it says, tell them to keep away from these things. Things that offer to idols.
Come on.
And promiscuity.
Mm-hmm.
Sex
that's
things.
That's good.
Those things right there in my life, man, I had to watch those. More than anything, I stumbled around and I stumbled, and if I stumbled into something like that in my life, I knew in my heart, man, I was like, that right there is grating to my spirit. I've got to do something about that right there. I couldn't rest with it. Even though I wasn't perfect, I asked Him for forgiveness. Sometimes in the very act, I'll forgive me, Lord. Help me, Jesus, to change this in my life. Help me, Lord. I can't live this way, Lord. I can't live this way. And here he was. He's like, get up and start walking with me again. I tell you what, our God is a holy God. And He wants to be there for us. And He says, my presence won't leave you. But don't you leave the presence either.
Right.
Don't you leave the presence. Because any Israelite could have seen that cloud and said, I'm leaving. I'm leaving. I'm going over here. And the Lord says, I'm still standing right there. Are you going to return? Because the Lord says, my presence did not leave.
Yeah.
My presence is still with you.
Yeah.
But you're walking off.
Yep.
You're leaving the presence of
yep.
the Lord.
Yep.
You're looking back and you're seeing the presence of the Lord. He said, I have never left you, nor let it forsook you.
That's
but you
right.
sure have left me.
That's right.
It forsook me.
Yep.
Come back closer to the fire again. And I will not leave you nor forsake you. But you've got to turn around.
Yeah.
You've got to turn around and come back to the fire. You've got to come back to the presence of the Lord. You've got to come back and get it right with the Lord.
Amen.
You have to say, Lord, it is your way and it ain't my way, Lord. I want your will in my life, Lord. I don't even know how to do it, Lord. But work with me, Father, that it will come to pass, Lord. Help me, Jesus, to do what you want me to do in my life, Lord. I'm not trying to do it under my own power. I need your presence with me, Lord. Day and night I need your presence with me, Lord. I turn back to you, Lord, and I look to you, Father, for my deliverance.
Yes.
I look to you, Lord God, for your healing in my life.
Amen.
See, God is God, isn't He?
Yes.
See, God is God. And you're saying, oh man, the Lord said, that's Old Testament stuff, that the Lord will never leave you or nor forsake you. You know, here He was in the desert, in their pillar of fire by night and in this cloud by day. Let's turn back to John 8:12 right now. John 8:12. When Jesus spoke again to the people, He said, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. You see, Jesus spoke this right here during the Feast of Tabernacles. You see, during the Feast of Tabernacles, during the 7 days of the feast, the Jews would be burned. They would burn 4 large lamps in the temple area. And these 4 lamps in the temple area, these things weren't small. These things were huge. And they say, you know, when people looked at the temple during this feast, it would light up the whole sky. It would light up the whole sky because of these big torches that were in the temple area. That what they were doing, they were celebrating the flame. They were celebrating the fire of God in the desert. They were saying, we remember, Lord, when you led us, Lord God, by the cloud by day and by the fire by night, Lord. And they were celebrating that during this feast. They were bringing the light there. And here's Jesus. And He's standing there with that backdrop behind Him. I am the light of the world.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I am the light of the world. And anyone who believes in me shall not walk in darkness. And there it was behind them. They were celebrating the fire that was in the desert.
Yeah.
And He says, I am the fire that was in the desert.
Yeah.
I am the great I am.
Yeah.
Jesus said, I am God.
Jesus.
I am the one that is the fire.
Yeah.
And I am the smoke. If you come and you live with me, I will never leave you nor forsake you.
Yes.
Oh, He was faithful to the Israelites, and He is faithful to us.
Right.
He is faithful to us. He is the I am. He's the I am of the fire. He's the I am of the desert. He's the I am that was in there. He's the I am that was the great I am. He says, I will never leave you nor forsake you. Oh, man, I tell you what, some of us need to turn back to our God. You say, Lord, I have been stumbling.
Yes.
See, a fish ain't supposed to be up on dry land. It's supposed to be in water. Some of us have left God in our life.
Come on.
And we said, Lord, I am stumbling around and I have no power. And the Lord says, I have not left you.
Thank you, God.
But you got to turn back to me.
Amen.
Yes.
I am your father and you are my child and I love you very much.
Thank you.
I love you very much. And it hurts my heart that you're going through this.
Yes.
If you'll return to me, if you'll return to me, I will take care of the spiritual condition. I will return to you. And I'll give you power back in your life. Ooh, I'll give you choice back.
Hallelujah.
I will help you overcome those things. As you turn back to me with your whole heart. And your whole mind. And your whole body.
Yes.
You know how it is to be out there. You know how it is to walk with the Lord. You know how it is to be in the presence of the Lord. And you also know how it is to turn your back. And see, the Lord wants us to turn back to Him. And say, Father, I want to turn back to you, Lord. I'm tired of stumbling around. Thank you for never leaving me, forsaking me, Lord. Thank you, Lord God, that your presence is there with me, Lord. Thank you, Lord God, as faithful ones in the Lord. You're not upset with us, Lord. You want us to get on and walk. But some of us have turned our backs, Lord, and we need to come back home today, Lord. We need to kneel toward you. We need to kneel before you, Lord. And I tell you what, sometimes that's rough. Sometimes we just got to get our pride to the side and say, Lord, I'm going to go kneel, Lord. I'm going to go do what you want me to do, Lord. I'm going to do it, Lord, because I got to have you.
Right.
Some people may be able to fake it, Lord. I can't fake it. I've got to have you, Lord. I've got to have my God in my life. It's not working this way. I've got to get it right with Him again. I've got to get my God back in my life. I need my power. I need my strength back. I need these things back in my life. It ain't working this way.
Yes.
Oh, Jesus, help me, Lord God, to turn back to you, Lord.
Thank you, Father.
In closing, and as Jerry comes to the front. In closing, God, our victory is in the presence of our God.
Amen.
The victory of God, the victory God has for us, He's not upset.
Amen.
He's not upset. He's not mad at you.
Amen.
See, He's not mad at you. You think He's mad at you. He's not mad at you because He took out His anger on Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus paid a price.
Yes.
So we wouldn't have to.
Right.
Jesus took it on Him so we wouldn't have to be taken upon.
Yes.
It was laid heavy upon Him so it wouldn't have to be laid heavy upon us.
Amen.
There's a story of this boy. This boy, he was a rotten little boy. And it's not me. This is another boy. It may have been Walt. And this boy was out on the playground. And he stuffed his friend's head down in the sand. And they took him to the office, to the principal. And the boy said, principal said, why did you stick that guy's head down in the sand? The boy just looked at him defiant. Said, I'm going to do what I want to do. And I'm going to do it the way I want to do it.
Yeah.
Are you going to whip me? See, that's the way we are with God sometimes. We'll do it the way I want to do it.
Yeah.
Are you going to whip me? And the principal looked at the boy and said, why are you so hard-hearted? And the boy just looked at him, and said, none of your business. The principal looked at the teacher and said, go get the belt. See, I grew up in a time when they got it.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I didn't want to see that paddle. They had a big old one there. And I've seen it enough. And that principal looked at the teacher and said, somebody's getting whipped today. This boy needs to learn about grace. And the boy looked at him and said, what do you mean, grace? Isn't that what you say before dinner? He said, no. Grace is something that Jesus fought for you. He was whipped so you wouldn't have to be. And the principal held out his hands. And that teacher started to crack down on his hands with that belt. And the principal went like this. He was like this, because it hurt. And the boy was looking at him. He says, I'm the one that's supposed to be whipped. Why are you being whipped? He said, it's because of grace.
Jesus.
You see, Jesus was whipped so we wouldn't have to be.
Amen.
And as that boy seen that principal take the beating that he was supposed to take, that boy started to cry and saying, please don't be beat anymore. Please don't be whipped anymore. I'm the one that did it. I'm the one that did it. I was wrong.
Yes.
I was wrong. That's the same way Jesus did. He said, I'm taking the beating. And I took the whipping so you wouldn't have to. Don't be defiant any longer. Come and surrender to me. See, the Lord did that. The Lord did that for us. So we wouldn't have to go through that. Stand with me today. Here today that says, you know, I've turned my back on it. I've turned my back. I've tried to do it my own way and it ain't working. I want you to come up here today. I want you to come and I want you to stand with me. If you're saying, you know, Lord, I need you in my life. And it ain't working the way I've got it going on right now, Lord. I'm looking to the arm of man. I'm looking to the things of man. And it's not working. I really need my God. You haven't left me, Lord God, but I left you. And I need to come back to you, Jesus. I need you in my life. I need you in my life, Lord. Is there anyone in here today that would say that's me? Would you raise your hand? Is there anyone in here today that says, I want to give my life to him afresh? I did before, but I want to do it fresh again today. I need Jesus in my life today. I don't need him just yesterday. I need him today. If you were to die today and you were to meet him, are you sure that you're okay? Do you know when you know her that you're okay? We believe that that is the first step to being delivered and to being set free is getting right with Jesus. Is there anyone? I'm going to wait just a moment. You see, I know that there is. Because the Lord would not have put this on my heart to teach today. If he knew who was going to be here. He knew it. And sometimes you say, well, I can receive him right where I'm at. You can. But it is something about stepping out before our God. Something is about walking down to the altar that says, Lord, I am repenting. I'm waiting. I want you to do what you have to do in my life. I'm just going to wait one more second and we'll move on. Is there anyone? Now I want the people to come. It says that sermon today was for me. That right there was for me. I have been being led by the Lord the best I know. But I have been stumbling around in the desert, Lord. Lord God, I need to be standing up on my feet again, Father God. I need to be walking with you, Lord, on a daily basis, Father God. I want to step out in assurance, Lord God, and in your power, Lord God, that you are not leaving me and you're not forsaking me, Lord God. I'm tired of beating up myself, Lord. I need to stand up before my God and to start worshiping him again and getting my mind right about my God. I need to have my mind right in the midst of the battle so I know that I can overcome it in the name of Jesus, that he's not left me. I need you to come on up here today if that was for you. To stand here with me. Come on and stand with me. Don't be bashful. Come and stand with me now. Yes, Lord. There's an anointing in here today. I said, come up here and stand with me. See, there's power in this when we start to step out, to start to believe God that he is a God.